Good morning everyone. Welcome to this session. In Engineering Mathematics 3, Unit 3 is Fourier Transform. We have already discussed Unit 1 and Unit 2, Laplace Transform, Inverse Laplace Transforms. Now Unit 3 is Fourier Transform. In Fourier Transform, we are going to discuss these contents. First one is basic definition of integral transforms, Fourier integral theorem, Fourier sine and cosine integrals, complex form of Fourier integrals, Fourier transform, Fourier sine and cosine transforms, properties of Fourier transform, and Parseval's identity for Fourier transforms. These are contents of Unit 3 Fourier transform. We are going to discuss one by one in our lecture series. In this lecture, our focus is on integral transforms, Fourier integral theorem, Fourier sine and cosine integrals. Before beginning this concept or this unit, some basic definitions or basic identities are required. So we are going to use some trigonometric identities. So I have listed some of them here. Even we need integration formulae. So I have listed all integration formulae in these slides. We need some more definitions. Those are definition of even function and odd function. You are familiar with these definitions. You have studied in your 12th standard indefinite integration. Here, even function means if in any function, if we replace variable by negative sign of that variable, that means if f of t equal to cos t, if f of t equal to cos t, this is a function of t. Here, if you replace this variable t by minus of t, then we get f of minus t equal to cos of minus t. But by using definition of cos minus theta equal to cos theta, this is trigonometric formula. So using this formula, cos minus t is nothing but cos t. But cos t is nothing but f of t. So here, f of t. So f of minus t equal to f of t. That's why f of t equal to cos t is an even function. In the same manner, if you replace t by minus t in any function, then if you get minus of f of t, then that function is called odd function. Here, if you consider f of t equal to sin t, if you replace t by minus t, f of minus t equal to sin minus t, but sin minus t equal to minus of sin t, because sin minus theta equal to minus of sin theta, trigonometric formula. So using this formula here, sin minus t equal to minus sin t, this can be written as minus of f of t. So here we have obtained f of minus t equal to minus of f of t for this function f of t equal to sin t. So f of t equal to sin t is an odd function. So we can define even and odd functions like this. You can identify even and odd functions by replacing this variable by minus of that variable. Now, if you consider two even functions, even function into even function gives even function, and odd function into even function gives odd function. Odd function into odd function gives even function. So even these formulae are required in solving some of these questions. Now we need some more integration formulae. I have not listed these two in previous slides. So I have given those formulae here. Integral e power a t into sin bt dt equal to e power a t by a square plus b square, a sin bt minus b cos bt, and integration of e power a t cos b t dt equal to e power a t upon a square plus b square into a cos b t plus b sin b t. Now let us discuss definition of integral transform. We have already seen this definition in our first unit, Laplace transforms. So usually integral transforms are mathematical tools which are used to transform one function to other function. That means here, if f of t is any given function, if you want to transform this f of t into f of s, then we use these integral transforms. By using integral transform, we can change or we can transform function of t to function of s. So basic definition of these integral transforms is like this: f of s equal to integral a to b k of t s into f of t dt. Here there are so many integral transforms. All these integral transforms, they differ in this kernel and in these units. So in Laplace transform, we have seen limits are from 0 to infinity, and here e power minus a t or minus s t, right? Kernel is e power minus s t. Here in Fourier transforms, limits are from minus infinity to plus infinity, and here kernel is e power I s t. So these integral transforms, they differ in these kernels. That means these integral transforms, in these integral transforms, so k of t s kernel differs from transform to transform, and even limits may vary from transform to transform. So using Fourier transforms, like Laplace transform, using Fourier transform, we can change any function from time domain to frequency domain. So time domain functions are nothing but signals which change according to time, which vary according to time. So these signals which are in time domain, they can be transformed to frequency domain using these transforms. And we can analyze signals even in time domain or in frequency domain using these transforms. So especially Fourier transform is very important tool in image processing. And here using this Fourier transform, we can decompose any signal into its constituent frequencies. So any function can be transformed from time domain to frequency domain, as well as we can decompose any signal as a sum of harmonic waves. So already we have seen Fourier series. Even using Fourier series, we are used Fourier series to decompose any periodic function into sine and cosine terms. That means any periodic function can be written as sum of sine and cosine terms using Fourier series. So but Fourier series is defined between a certain range, some minus L to L, minus pi to pi, or 0 to pi, like that. So if you extend that range from minus infinity to infinity, then Fourier series will be converted to Fourier integral. So from Fourier integrals, we can derive Fourier transform. So first let us see Fourier series. Let us recall concept of Fourier series. So here, to define or to expand any function in the form of Fourier series, that function should satisfy some conditions. Those conditions are called Dirichlet's conditions. So function f(x) must be integrable over a period, and f(x) must have finite number of maxima minima. That means here, if we draw graph to any function, that graph should have finite number of maxima minima. That means here if graph is like this, then these are maximum points and these are minimum points. So these points should be finite. And fx must have finite number of discontinuities. If function is discontinuous, then if you draw a graph, then it has breaks in between. These are called discontinuities. So function must have finite number of discontinuities, and also fx must be bounded. Now let us define Fourier series. If any periodic function fx satisfying these Dirichlet's conditions in the range minus L to L, then it can be represented as Fourier series on real number set. Now here fx is periodic function. Periodic function means if fx equal to f of x plus t, which is equal to f of x plus 2t, equal to so on sine of 0 equal to sine of 0 plus 2 pi equal to sine 0 plus 4 pi equal to so on. Here value of sine 0 is 0. Sine 2 pi plus theta equal to sine theta. Then sine 4 pi plus theta is also equal to sine theta. So all these functions, they are producing same value 0. So sine theta is a periodic function. If you understand this concept using its graph, here if you consider a unit circle, sine 0, here theta equal to 0, so sine 0 is 0. If you consider one rotation, 2 pi rotation, then after 2 pi degree rotation, 360 degree rotation, here this point is coming to the same point again. Again value of sine 2 pi is 0. Then if you take one more rotation, value of sine 4 pi is also 0. Value of sine 6 pi equal to 0. So after 2 pi degree period or 2 pi degree rotation, the function sine theta is having same value. That's why this is called periodic function. So any periodic function which satisfies Dirichlet's conditions can be expanded using Fourier series. So Fourier, but here range should be finite range, minus L to L. That means range may be minus pi to plus pi, or minus L to plus L, or minus 2 pi to plus 2 pi, or 0 to 2 pi, so on. Range must be finite. Then it can be represented as Fourier series. So fx equal to form of this Fourier series is nothing but fx equal to a naught by 2 plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity an cos n pi x by l plus bn sin n pi x by l, where a naught, an, bn are called Fourier coefficients. So we can define a naught, an, bn as 1 by l integral minus l to l fx dx, an equal to 1 by l integral minus l to l fx cos n pi x by l dx, bn equal to 1 by l integral minus l to l fx sin n pi x by l dx. So any periodic signal can be decomposed as sine and cosine waves using Fourier series. But Fourier series fails to decompose a non-periodic signal. So non-periodic functions cannot be expanded in the form of Fourier series. But if we extend this range minus L to L to minus infinity to plus infinity, then we can expand any non-periodic signal also. That means when this range L tends to infinity in Fourier series, the frequencies become closely spaced and the discrete Fourier spectrum becomes continuous Fourier spectrum called Fourier transform of fx. That means, let us see this diagram. Here if you consider these signals, here fp of t, here this is Fourier series representation. So here This t naught represents this range plus L, and if you extend this range, if you increase this range t naught, here t naught equal to 1 second, here t naught equal to 2 seconds, here t naught equal to 4 seconds, here t naught tends to infinity. T naught is nothing but L. L tends to infinity. Here L equal to 1 second, L equal to 2 seconds, 4 seconds, so on. If you increase this range, then in this frequency spectrum, if you see these waves, here, whenever this L tends to infinity, L or T naught tends to infinity, these frequencies are closely spaced. Here, the space between these frequencies, it is decreasing. If this L or T naught tends to infinity, then these frequencies are densely or closely packed. Then this gives a continuous spectrum. So, frequency spectrum is continuous function. Okay. So, whenever this range minus L to L tends to minus infinity to plus infinity, then we get a continuous frequency, continuous function. That means frequency spectrum is continuous of here. Frequency spectrum is a continuous function of omega. Omega is nothing but frequency. Okay. So here we get a closely packed frequency spectrum when L tends to infinity. This is nothing but Fourier transform. So Fourier series, from Fourier series we can obtain Fourier transform by extending this range minus L to L, from minus L to L to minus infinity to plus infinity. Or if we take L, or if we increase L to infinity, if L tends to infinity, then this Fourier series will give a Fourier transform. Now Fourier spectrum becomes here, this can be obtained from, so here this Fourier transform can be obtained from complex Fourier integral. This Fourier integral, complex Fourier integral, they can be derived from Fourier series by taking L tends to infinity. Now Fourier sine integral can be derived from Fourier sine series, and Fourier cosine integral can be derived from Fourier cosine series. So any periodic or non-periodic functions can be expressed in the form of Fourier integral. But using Fourier series, we can expand only periodic functions. But both periodic and non-periodic functions can be expressed in the form of Fourier integral. Okay. Usually we have derived Laplace transform from power series, discrete power series, by taking continuous sum. In the same manner, Fourier transform can be derived from Fourier series by extending range L to infinity. Okay, so we have already discussed this diagram. Now, Fourier integral, let us see definition of Fourier integral. If fx is periodic function satisfying Dirichlet conditions in the range minus infinity to plus infinity, then it can be represented as Fourier integral. Or if fx is a non-periodic function, then fx can be represented in Fourier integral form over entire real line. So on real line, if this is real line from 0, here 1, 2, 3, so on, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, so on. So on this entire real line, fx, if fx is non-periodic function, it can be expressed in the form of Fourier integral. Now let us see definition of Fourier integral. Here if fx satisfies Dirichlet's conditions in every interval minus L to L, and integral minus infinity to infinity fx dx converges, that is this integral produces a finite value, then in the interval minus infinity to plus infinity, then fx can be written as 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda into t minus x d lambda dt. So this integral is called Fourier integral. This can be derived from Fourier series by taking L tends to infinity. So let us see that proof. Here in this proof, we consider the function fx satisfies Dirichlet's conditions in the interval minus L to L. Also, integral minus infinity to infinity fx dx is convergent. That means it gives a finite value. Then in minus L to L, we can write Fourier series in this manner. Fx equal to a naught by 2 plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity an cos n pi x by L plus bn sin n pi x by L. Now, let us replace a naught an bn by their particular formulae in equation 1. Then fx gives 1 by 2L integral minus L to L f of t dt. Here in the place of a naught, if we write this formula in the place of an, write bn here, then we get this formula. Here, after replacing a naught, an, bn by their particular values, we can write this second term as 1 by L summation n equal to 1 to infinity. Here both these terms, they have same integral, integral minus L to L. That's why integral minus L to L f of t we have taken outside, integral minus L to L f of t, and 1 by L also we have taken outside. Then within the bracket we have written remaining terms, that means cos n pi t by L cos n pi x by L plus sin n pi t by L into sin n pi x by L into dt. Dt is also same for both the terms, that's why we have written it outside. Now here this is similar to trigonometric identity, cos a cos b plus sin a sin b, that is nothing but cos a minus b. So we can write it as cos of n pi t by L minus n pi x by L dt. All remaining terms no change. Now here that can be written as 1 by 2L integral minus L to L f of t dt plus 1 by L summation n equal to 1 to infinity integral minus L to L f of t into cos n pi by L, I have taken outside, n pi by L into t minus x dt. Here fx is uniformly convergent in the interval minus L to L. So we can take this summation inside the integral. So if you take this summation inside the integral, that gives one. Here first term as it is no change. Second term is 1 by L integral minus L to L f of t into summation n equal to 1 to infinity cos n pi by L into t minus x dt. Now here if we take 1 by 2L integral minus L to L f of t dt common from these two terms, then here in the place of first term we get 1 plus here summation n equal to 1 to infinity, here this integral we have taken outside, then here this is 1 by 2L, that's why here 2 cos n pi by L into t minus x dt. Now here 2 cos theta, this can be written as cos theta plus cos minus theta, because 2 cos theta is nothing but 2 cos theta is nothing but cos theta plus cos theta. Cos minus theta equal to cos theta, so we can write this as cos minus theta plus cos theta. So here we have written cos of n pi by L, that means 2 cos theta can be written as cos of minus theta plus cos theta. That's why we have written this term as cos n pi by L into t minus x plus cos minus n pi by L into t minus x. Now after writing this in this manner, here the term which is outside the bracket as it is no change, here 1 plus here cos minus theta and here this is cos theta, that's why here we can change this range n equal to 1 to infinity to n equal to minus infinity to plus infinity. We can write this n from minus infinity to plus infinity, then cos of n pi by L into t minus n pi by L of t minus x. Okay, cos n pi by L into t minus x dt. So because cos minus theta is on contains negative theta minus negative angle, and this is positive angle. That's why this summation changes to n equal to minus, from n equal to minus infinity to n equal to infinity. Okay, now here again take this integral inside, then we get 1 by 2l integral minus l to l f of t dt plus 1 by 2l integral minus l to l f of t into this summation dt. Now this summation can be written as 1 by 2l integral minus l to l f of t dt as it is. Here summation we have taken inside, but here 1 by 2 pi, 1 by 2l, we have adjusted 1 by 2l as 1 by 2 pi into pi by l, and pi by l is taken inside the integral. So 1 by 2 pi integral minus l to l f of t into pi by l summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity cos of n pi by l e to t minus x dt. Now if this l tends to infinity, then this first integral tends to 0. This is equal to 0. And here we are using definition of integral as a limit of sum. Then this can be written as limit l tends to infinity pi by l summation n equal to minus infinity to infinity cos n pi by l into t minus x can be written as integral minus infinity to plus infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda. This lambda represents n pi by l, and d lambda is nothing but pi by l. So we can write this limit of this sum as continuous summation using integration. Here l tends to infinity means pi by l tends to 0. So pi by l tends to 0, limit pi by l tends to 0, pi by l into summation n equal to minus infinity to plus infinity cos of n pi by l into t minus x. This can be written as integral minus infinity to infinity cos of lambda into t minus x d lambda. Here n pi by l is considered as lambda and pi by l is d lambda. Okay, now this function fx changes to fx equal to first integral becomes 0, then here second integral 1 by 2 pi integral minus infinity to plus infinity f of t into this pi by l into this summation is changed to integral minus infinity to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda, and here dt is there, so into dt. Okay, so here now here integral minus infinity to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda. Here cos function is even function in terms of lambda. So integral minus infinity to infinity, this cos function can be written as 2 integral 0 to infinity cos lambda into t minus x, because we have one definite integration formula. That formula is integral minus a to a, integral minus a to a fx dx equal to 2 integral 0 to a fx dx if fx is even function. So using this formula we can write integral minus infinity to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda as 2 integral 0 to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda. Okay, now I think you have understood application of this formula here. So integral minus infinity to infinity cos lambda into t minus x, sorry, here this is d lambda, this is d lambda, equal to 2 integral 0 to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda, since cos lambda into t minus x is even in lambda. That's why here fx can be written as fx equal to 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda into t minus x d lambda dt, because here these two numbers will get cancelled. We get 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity cos lambda into t minus x d lambda dt. This is called Fourier integral. Now here we can write this Fourier integral in other form also. So let us see that. Now we have derived this formula, Fourier integral formula, as fx equal to 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda into t minus x d lambda dt. Now here we can expand this using trigonometric identity cos a minus b. Here this term can be written as cos lambda t minus lambda x. Then if you expand this using cos a minus b identity, we get here 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t. This cos term can be written as cos lambda t cos lambda x plus sin lambda x d lambda dt using cos a minus b identity. Now we can apply these integrals to both these terms. That means 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda x d lambda dt plus 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t sin lambda x d lambda dt. Now if we write integral 0 to infinity outside and integral minus infinity to infinity inside, then we can write these integrals as 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt within one square bracket into cos lambda x d lambda. That means we have written all t terms together. Even in this second term, we have written t terms together. That's why within the bracket, we have written integral minus infinity to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt and remaining terms and other integral outside this bracket. Now, here we can club these. We can take integral 0 to 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity outside. So 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity, then this one, this whole term here into cos lambda x plus this whole square bracket into sin lambda x into d lambda. D lambda is also common to both these terms. So we have written d lambda outside. Then 1 by pi integral 0 to infinity at the beginning. Now integral 0 to infinity, if you take this 1 by pi inside, here 1 by pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt into cos lambda x. Then here 1 by pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt into sin lambda x d lambda. Now if we consider this whole term as a lambda and this whole bracket, square bracket, as b lambda. If you consider first square bracket as a lambda, second square bracket as b lambda, then we can write this fx as fx equal to integral 0 to infinity a lambda cos lambda x plus b lambda sin lambda x d lambda, where a lambda equal to 1 by pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt and b lambda equal to 1 by pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt. So here this fx is nothing but other form of a Fourier integral. So if it is asked to evaluate or to find this Fourier integral, you can use any one of these formulae, this one, otherwise this one. So if we use this second form, we have to find a lambda and b lambda first, then we replace those values in this integral, then we have to evaluate to get Fourier integral. But if you use this first form directly, you can evaluate this double integration. Okay, now let us see Fourier cosine integral. To obtain Fourier cosine integral, we use Fourier integral formula first. So here Fourier integral is fx equal to integral 0 to infinity a lambda cos lambda x plus b lambda sin lambda x d lambda. Now here fx is even function. Consider this fx as even function. If fx is even, then f of t is also an even function. Then f of t cos lambda t is even function. We have seen even into even gives even. Even into odd gives odd function. So f of t cos lambda t is even. F of t sin lambda t is odd function. Then this a lambda equal to 1 by pi integral minus infinity to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt. Here this whole function is even. So we can write it as 2 integral 0 to infinity 1 by pi as it is 1 by pi into 2 integral 0 to infinity. That means 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt using this definite integration formula. If this function is even function, then we can write in the form of 2 integral 0 to a fx dx. Okay, so here in the place of fx there are two functions f of t cos lambda t, but product of these two functions is again an even function. So we can apply this definite integration formula here. Now if you apply same formula on b lambda, here f of t sin lambda t is odd function. So if function is odd, this is equal to value of integral is 0. So here b lambda becomes 0 according to this definite integration formula. So here if you replace values of a lambda and b lambda in this f of x, we get f of x equal to integral 0 to infinity a lambda cos lambda x plus 0 into sin lambda x d lambda. Now this is nothing but integral 0 to infinity a lambda cos lambda x d lambda, where a lambda equal to 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt. So if you replace a lambda by its particular formula, then we get fx equal to 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity cos lambda x integral 0 to infinity f of t cos lambda t dt d lambda. This is Fourier cosine integral. In the same manner, we can obtain Fourier sine integral also. So to obtain Fourier sine integral, again consider Fourier integral formula. Here consider fx as an odd function. Here if fx is odd function, then f of t is also odd. Then f of t cos lambda t odd into even is odd, and f of t sin lambda t odd into odd gives even function. So f of t sin lambda t is even, f of t cos lambda t is odd if fx is odd function. Okay, then a lambda becomes 0 because a lambda contains f of t cos lambda t. F of t cos lambda t is odd. So by using definite integration formula, value of this integral becomes 0. B lambda, here in B lambda, f of t sin lambda t is even function. So this integral can be written as 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt. Again here by using definite integration formula. Now this fx changes to integral 0 to infinity 0 into cos lambda x plus b lambda sin lambda x d lambda. Now here first term becomes 0, so we get fx equal to integral 0 to infinity b lambda sin lambda x d lambda, where b lambda equal to 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt. So if you replace b lambda by its formula, we get fx equal to 2 by pi integral 0 to infinity sin lambda x integral 0 to infinity f of t sin lambda t dt into d lambda. This is called Fourier sine integral. So we have discussed Fourier integral, Fourier sine integral and Fourier cosine integral. In next session, let us discuss some examples on these Fourier integrals before discussing Fourier transform. Thank you. Let us meet in next session.